So we'll try to talk about the hyperglycemic emergencies, both in terms of diabetic ketoacidosis and hyperosmolar coma. So what do you think are the major differences, Sayan, in terms of hyperosmolar coma and DK?
So the level of increase in osmolarity, so the level of dehydration.
And no
acidosis.
Most importantly, lack of ketoacidosis. So why is it different? Why are the two different? What is the basic difference in the pathophysiology of HONK versus DK?
So absolute insulin deficiency is
Mm-hmm. And in HONK, you have relative, you have some preserved insulin. So you have got enough to avoid ketoacidosis from happening, but your hyperglycemia keeps on going. So the reason why most patients with DK present to you is because of ketoacidotic symptoms, vomiting, respiratory rate issues, abdominal pain. These are all ketoacidosis features. So they bring you early. That's why your glucose levels are not that high. But in cases of HONK, you will have delayed presentation because only cause effect is dehydration. You will become obtunded only when the osmolality goes beyond 320, 340, something like that. That's why you have a late presentation which happens in that perspective. So this is a major difference which happens in that regard. So now, why is ketosis absent in HONK? One is insulin. But often insulin is also low in type 2. We say 50 to 60% insulin is already gone by that time. But still, they do not develop ketoacidosis. So when you say that insulin is there, not completely deficient, any other factor which can affect that? Which affects ketogenesis? They are high there also. If your osmolality is very high, it suppresses ketogenesis. That itself is another factor which really prevents this from happening. Now, Naveen, in what situations type 1 can behave like HONK? Which type 1 patients can present more with HONK rather than DK?
So, what are these carbonated?
Yes. So, if you have taken a lot of things like cold drinks, those things which have got very high sugar content, you can have that situation. When can HONK behave like DK? Like type 2, more like DK? In what situations? So they are type 2. So essentially, if there is a renal dysfunction, if there is hypoperfusion, they will develop lactic acidosis. So acidosis will develop. So while both of them are considered to be a different entities, I would say it's more like an overlap. In one, it is mainly in terms of insulin deficiency causing ketoacidosis with hyperglycemia. The other is mainly in terms of hyperglycemia causing dehydration with some ketoacidosis, but both have got both. That is why the overlap is there. And that's what we're going to discuss today in detail with regards to that. But even in developed areas, it's around 15 to 30%. In our experience, it will be like 60, 70%. We have seen a decline, which is a positive sign. That's why it's being picked up early, but still it is to the tune of 60 to 70%. And that I think you can tell the answer once you get the data from your perspective. Now, recurrent DK is 1 to 10% per year. What are the most common risk factors for recurrent DK, Dr. Manoj?
Because of the improper sick pay management, the insulin is not taken properly.
And social issues, socio-economic issues. So when you look at the overall recurrence rate of DK, maybe 4 or 5% explain 40% of all cases. So same person will keep on coming many times. We have a few patients who have come 4 or 5 times with DK, which means that there is either a problem in the economic constraints, but that should not happen because we are trying to take care of those patients and providing them insulin, which means there is more of a social issue. And often in adolescent girls, there is a higher risk of developing. So it's more like an attention seeking. They are so desperate at house that they want to have this sort of a way. And this is an important thing to remember. So psychosocial counseling also becomes very, very important. Type 2, as discussed, 5 to 6% may present with DK. First episode will be more common in younger individuals and in lower socioeconomic status and in somebody who doesn't know about diabetes. But sometime that we saw today, you can also have the person who had a sibling with diabetes, type 1 diabetes, still develop DK. So it's basically depend upon multiple other factors. Second episode is usually because of missed dose or sick day, as you've discussed, inappropriate management, and psychosocial issues become important from that regards. Now, DKA is by far the major cause of mortality in type 1 diabetes, and the main cause of mortality in DKA is? So, if you talk overall, 60% to 70% deaths which happen in DKA are because of febrile edema. And early deaths which happen in type 1, I'm not talking about CKD and long-term outcome, are mainly because of DKA. So, if you can prevent DKA, if you can prevent febrile edema or treat febrile edema, lot of lives can be saved from that perspective. So we'll talk about that in terms of pathophysiology. So essentially, DKA is of two major aspects: insulin deficiency, and usually it is absolute. It may be relative also as regards to the counter-regulatory hormones. Now, which is more important, insulin deficiency or counter-regulatory excess? Okay, and so if you do not have a counter-regulatory excess, will you develop DKA? So what are the three things you require for DKA to develop? You said insulin deficiency, counter-regulatory excess, and third?
Dehydration
is a part of DKA. You need what to produce ketones? You need to have fat. So that is the third component. If the adipose tissue is not there, like lipodystrophy or somebody who is really malnourished, ketoacidosis may not be that common in that setting. Now, how do you know that the counter-regulatory hormones play an important role in the pathogenesis of DKA?
So if the counter-regulatory hormones are not acting, then how will the ketones be produced?
So insulin deficiency will also cause some ketosis because insulin inhibits ketosis.
Yes.
So do you think of evidence, how can you really prove this hypothesis that counter-regulatory hormones are very important?
Sir, the cortisol status, if you check the cortisol, it is more than normal.
If you have somebody who has a multiple pituitary hormone deficiency, Manoj, will they develop DKA earlier or later than somebody who has normal pituitary functions?
Because
so this is one of the proofs. That studies have shown that those who have MPHD develop DKA later on. Once you give fluid, Naveen, then what happens to the glucose levels?
So they go, dramatic fall occurs in the first quarter.
Why?
So that is because, sir, we are basically restoring the intravascular volume and also...
So restoration of volume will cause decrease in cortisol, epinephrine and all that thing. So these two are big proofs that both are very, very important. And counter-regulatory are very important from the absolute terms. Like many patients may not develop unless this excess happens. That's why when you have stress, when you have infection, when you have dehydration, you develop DKA. That is because of this counter-regulatory, because insulin deficiency was there. But now, because of this, the problems happen, but both are equally important in that regards. Now, insulin deficiency, as discussed earlier, along with the excess amount of growth hormone will do what? Which of these is lipolytic? GH. So you will have lipolysis, you will have fatty acids, which will then be converted into ketones. And this ketoacidosis is going to cause all those problems. Acidosis, rapid breathing, abdominal pain, vomiting, all those problems. And that's why you will present early. And that's why the hyperglycemia may not be that severe and the dehydration will not be that severe. Now, what do the counter-regulatory hormones do? This, along with insulin deficiency, will cause excess amount of glucose. And once there is increased hepatic production via glycogenolysis and increased renal production via gluconeogenesis, a lot of glucose is there in the blood. Now, this glucose will be lost in the kidneys. And what will this glucosuria cause?
Sir, because of the glucose is going in, so sodium and potassium and electrolytes will follow and along with water. So dehydration with the...
So you will have massive losses of potassium, sodium and water, which will happen in that regards. So you will have very low level of potassium, which is there in the blood, in the overall body. But why is the potassium in the blood not low in DKA?
Because of the insulin deficiency, intravascular shift of potassium.
So insulin deficiency, 1 second.
Because of the urinary loss.
Urinary loss will cause more potassium. Potassium should be low. Anything else? You said about insulin deficiency. Anything else? Acidosis. So these two will prevent the severe hypokalemia in the blood. But in the entire system, you will have massive losses which will be there. With hypokalemia, which other ions will also go down, Naveen?
Sir, calcium will go down. Sir, magnesium.
Magnesium and phosphorus. So there are three intracellular ions: potassium, magnesium, and phosphorus. Any is low, the other will also go down. So hypomagnesemia and hypophosphatemia are classical features which are there, which you expect along with hypokalemia and decay. So what will be the manifestations of hypophosphatemia?
Sir, hypophosphatemia basically causes a shift of the oxygen sourcing for the liver.
Why?
Sir, because of the decrease in 2-3-BPT levels.
Yeah.
As a result of a decrease in ODP, there will be hypoxia. So,
Just hold on. So let's go slow. Your phosphorus level is low. You will have less level of diphosphoglycerol. What will it do to the oxygen dissociation curve?
Shift
the curve to the
left.
Okay.
So oxygen delivery to the tissue will be minimized.
And
as a result of which, there will be endogen function dysfunction.
So there will be metabolic acidosis. So basically, hypophosphatemia will cause the shift to the left, which will basically cause all the problems. Now, what does acidosis do to the curve? Shift to the right. So in a normal situation, maybe this problem may not be very significant, because if your decay is untreated, you have acidosis, which is taking it towards the right, while phosphorus deficiency is taking it to the left. But once you correct acidosis, this can be a problem. So hypophosphatemia will cause persistent acidosis, which is metabolic and which is lactic acidosis. Number one. Number two, what will it do to muscles?
Sir, it can trigger rhabdomyolysis.
So myopathy, rhabdomyolysis, creatine kinase rise, those problems can happen because of phosphorus in that setting. So these are the problems which happen. So you have loss of a lot of these things and, of course, a lot of water. Because if there is an osmotic diuresis, everything goes out in that perspective and you will have dehydration. But the level of dehydration will be much lower because you will die because of this acidosis. So now you need to understand that here, if you are not detected here, the person will die. So he will not become severely dehydrated. So what are the level of dehydration do you see in this perspective, in this setting? How much in decay?
In decay. So that will depend on the severity of decay.
What is the usual?
So generally, clinical signs of dehydration.
No. What is the percentage dehydration in decay?
5-7%.
7-10. So severe upper limit will be 10. Don't go beyond 10. 5 will be like mild. So mild decay, we are not discussing too much today. We are talking about moderate to severe. So roughly, if you talk about pH, suppose somebody has a pH of 6.9, how much dehydration is there?
10%.
Up to 10%. So I think what we are trying to say is that clinical judgment of dehydration is difficult in decay. So, is BSPD guidelines earlier used to in fact say that you just go by pH, 7.1 more than 7.1. But of course, you have to look at everything. But generally, if your pH is less than 7, minimum 10% dehydration is there. If it is more than 7.1, then you consider 7%. If it is more than 7.2, it's 5%. That will be a rough idea. You of course have to look at multiple other factors in terms of assessment of dehydration, which are there. Now, what we are seeing here is that this volume goes down. So, this hypovolemia, Dr. Pratik, will cause what all things?
Sir, after hypovolemia, we get gas activation.
Yes.
So, following gas activation, we get even more hypokalemia.
Yes. So, volume depletion will, one, of course, we have discussed earlier, cause counter-regulatory hormone, which will cause more hyperglycemia. So, again, a vicious cycle will keep on going. And the RAS active will be there. And that's why you will have hypokalemia. So what it means is that if you give this normal saline bolus, it will not only decrease your glucose, it will also improve your potassium. What is essential for anybody to have chronic hypokalemia? Which is the most important thing which sustains hypokalemia in any disorder? High level of, which is the RAS. So anybody who has persistent hypokalemia has to have a high RAS. Otherwise, you will not have persistent hypokalemia. So here the mechanism of persistent hypokalemia, of course, you lost potassium. But then the body should conserve. It should start conserving. But because of this RAS axis, you have consistent amount of this problem. Now, what about sodium? What do you think sodium will have a situation will happen in the setting of decay?
Sir, sodium will have like natural sodium will be actually very low, sir. Mm-hmm. But it is basically because of the dilutional.
Sodium depletion will be there?
So there will be sodium in there, but body, because the RSA will generally try to conserve sodium. Mm-hmm. So.
But what else also gets activated if your volume is less?
Sir.
AVP. What will it do?
Hyponatremia.
So again, it's a confusing picture, but what you need to understand is that because of this hypovolemia, you have got high RAS, which is causing hypokalemia, which is persisting. And because of this hypovolemia, you have got high AVP, which is causing hyponatremia. So you've got this whole loop continuously going. And that's why decay is a vicious cycle. You have got hyperglycemia. Hyperglycemia is basically causing osmotic diuresis, hypovolemia, counter-regulatory hormone, again causing that. So it keeps on going in circles in that setting. And of course, if you have hypoperfusion, atherosis will start worsening. So all those factors will happen in that regard. So what is the impact? We've discussed that dehydration is roughly 7 to 10%. 5%, 7.2 and above, 7%, 7.1 to 7.2, 10% less than 7.1 generally. You can't just have 100% correlation on that. The problem is, how do you estimate dehydration and what are the fallacies in estimation of hydration and decay?
It's 82 by severe cases. Sir,
will you underestimate or overestimate dehydration?
Sir, underestimate.
Why?
Sir, because the volume will be conserved. Because high osmolar state, it will draw all the body to the extracellular space.
So if you look at the skin turgor, what will happen to the skin turgor? Will it be decreased or not?
Skin turgor will be decreased.
Skin turgor will not be decreased because you have got more osmolarity. Like hypernatremic dehydration, you have got the Duffy skin, the same thing will happen. But if you look at the mucosa, what will happen?
So mucosa will be dry.
Much more dry because you are breathing much, you have got tachycardia. So this is a paradoxical state. If you look at the skin turgor, you will underestimate. If you look at the tongue, you will overestimate. So studies have shown that there is a poor correlation between level of dehydration and the clinical assessment and the actual level of dehydration. They did some water studies to look at the actual levels, and then they found that it was a poor correlation. So what I'm trying to say is that go more by the overall clinical picture, severity of atherosis, and then you make an estimate. Of course, the key, what are the key signs of real hypovolemia?
One is impalpable pulses,
shock,
pulses, yeah. Capillary refill tank low, hypotension. These are the main
things. So major things and anuria. Oligoanuria is a major problem that you would look at. Then cold peripheries, of course, they won't be affected. CFT, BP, all those parameters will become important in that setting. So dehydration is something which is important to impact. What happens to the sodium? How much sodium is lost?
For 100 milligram increase.
That is a different thing. You're talking about, I'm not trying to say what is the deficit.
Six
millimoles per kg is the rough deficit that is there. And that is because of loss in the urine, and then your AVP comes into the picture and everything. Now, would you underestimate or overestimate this?
Sir, we are overestimating sodium.
Because you have got, why does it happen?
Because of the dilution.
So why is this dilutional hyponatremia happening?
Because to maintain the osmolarity.
So, because of the increased extra plasma glucose, the water will come out of the cells. And that's why you've got this hyponatremia which is happening. And how do you correct for this?
Sir, we have to correct, means we have every 100 milligram of increasing sugar, so that's for 5.5.
For every 100 milligram per DL, you have to add 1.6 or 2. There are two different cutoffs. Whatever calculations you are comfortable, you use 1.6 or 2 in that perspective, and this is because of the drag, the osmotic drag, which is causing this issue. So 1.6 millimoles or 2 per 100 is what is there in that regards. Now, what happens to potassium? We already discussed that there is a potassium deficit, but falsely the potassium levels are high in that setting because you have got the sodium OTPase channel, and because of acidosis, the potassium is coming out essentially in that perspective. Now, what will happen once you start treatment?
Sir, once you start treatment, there will be fall in the potassium because of the appearing insulin, and all the potassium which is present in the cell will be driven into the cells.
So, if you just do hydration, your potassium may go up. But if you're giving insulin, potassium will come down. And as soon as your acidosis corrects, potassium will come down. So if you have somebody whose potassium is low at diagnosis, what will you do?
Sir, we need to immediately start our potassium because in such cases, there will be severe intracellular stores are very low.
So if you are very, very low at the offset, it means that there is a big problem you're dealing with in that perspective. But
it will be deferred also in such cases. It is very low. Unless the potassium level is normalized, we need to differentiate.
So that's a very, very important issue in that regard. So insulin and acidosis, once you give insulin, once you correct acidosis, this problem will cause a huge defect which will happen. Now for every, you can use every 0.1 change in terms of pH, potassium roughly goes up by 0.6. So let's say somebody had a pH of 6.9. So and his potassium is 5.4. How much is the actual corrected potassium, Pratik? So 6.9, you take 7.4 as an answer, 0.5 into? Yeah. 3. So that will be like 5.4 will become 2.4. So if you just use your brain, you can easily identify, okay, this fellow is having severe hypokalemia, but only because of acidosis, his potassium is going up. So this formula, we all talk about this 1.62 formula, but this is also very important. For every 0.1 decline in pH, potassium goes up by 0.6. So this is a false increase in potassium which is happening in that setting. Of course, we discussed there's a law of fall of phosphorus and fall of magnesium. What does hypomagnesemia do? What will hypomagnesemia worsen in this already the setting? Hypokalemia. So we talk about refractory hypokalemia, you think of magnesium. So if your potassium is persistently low, think of magnesium deficiency again. So hypomagnesemia is also important from that regards. Now what happens once we start treatment? So now once we give fluid, we discuss the first thing which happens is counter-regulatory hormones go down and the volume expands. So suppose you've given 10%, 10 ml per kg in that setting. Of course, your volume is increased by 10%. So what is going to happen now is that suddenly your glucose will come down. Counter-regulatory hormones will come down. Glucose will come down. So within the first 1 hour, you have a loss of around 100 milligram per DL. Glucose will automatically come down in that perspective. Now, with this, you have to start insulin. Your essential process of ketogenesis and will also only decrease once you start insulin. Without insulin, ketoacidosis is not going to resolve. So you have to give insulin in that perspective. And this is different from hyperosmolar state. In hyperosmolar state, would you like to start insulin early or when do you start insulin?
Sir, we try to give fluids only in case if the blood sugar level is not falling below above 50 milligram per day.
Yeah.
Then we can sit on insulin.
Exactly. So this is an important point to remember. In DKA, you have to start insulin right for offset. While in hyperosmolar, you want to start it a bit late, only when the fall of glucose is less than 50 milligram per DL per hour in that regards. Now, if you give too much fluid, what problems, Dr. Pratik, will happen?
So there is high risk of cerebral
edema. Yes, and?
And if you give too much fluid, so the fall of insulin, the fall of
sugar. Anything else? What will, you're giving, the fluid you're giving has what? So if you give too much fluid, you will have hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis, which will also happen in that regard. If you give too much insulin, what will happen?
So one is hypoglycemia, second is hypokalemia.
That's very important. And I'm more bothered about hypokalemia because that can cause a rapid decrease, which is there. Do you need to give an insulin infusion directly or do you need to give a loading dose?
The loading dose has no load now because it has been seen it increases chances of cerebral edema.
And you, the if you start infusion very quickly, the levels are reached. So if you look at the graph, that this is the insulin, and you start within 30 to 40 minutes, your levels will be in the target range. So there is no role of giving an insulin bolus in that regard. And we already discussed that your sugars have already fallen 100 to 200. Why are you bothered about giving rapid fall? That's why insulin bolus has no role. And infusion will cause that. But if you give too much, you will have hypokalemia, which will happen. Now, what are the major complications? And we've discussed that the major cause of death, 60 to 80% in DKA, is cerebral edema. When, in which children will you be concerned that this is at a high risk of developing cerebral edema?
So children below 2 years of age, severe DKA is severe acidosis. And children who treated outside in periphery, who having multiple doses of insulin, subcutaneous.
So you have said one, severity of DKA, age as a criteria. Third, you said outside treatment, maybe fluid has been given and something has been given. Anything else?
Subcutaneous insulin.
Anything else, bicarb, these are all known, this thing. So if you look at the blood gas, you look at this and you say, okay, he's at a very high risk of developing.
Sir, means below 7 pH.
Everybody is seven, less than 7 pH mostly that we see. Anything else within that?
Sir, we look at PCO2, sir. If it is less than 10, then it predicts.
That's very important. So what are the normal CO2 response to bicarbonate, metabolic acidosis? How much should be CO2 in somebody who has a metabolic acidosis?
Sir, CO2,
let's say bicarb is 10, what should be the CO2? How much? What is the compensation formula?
So 1.5 to bicarbonate plus 8 and 10
plus 6. So 10 would be 21. But let's say you have got 4. Even 4 will be 12. At bicarbonate of 4, CO2 minimum should be 12. If your CO2 is below 10, it means that there is, which means there is CNS hyperventilation, which means there's already some pressure happening up there. So if your CO2 is less than 10, that is a major, major cause of worry. pH less than 6.9, CO2 less than 10, outside fluid treatment, that is a major in terms of our complications. We'll talk about the international data also in that regards. So severe disease, too much fluid, soda bicarbonate, and osmotic shift, of course, cause cerebral edema. High mortality, morbidity, you give less fluid, slow correction. This is something which a lot of debate has come up. So we'll discuss about whether fluid management determines cerebral edema or is it something else which causes cerebral edema in that regards. And mannitol can be life-saving in that perspective. How does mannitol help in the setting? Yeah, but now a lot of people are saying that actually it is not cerebral edema. It is a cytotoxic injury rather than cerebral edema. So how does mannitol help in that situation? They say it is hypoxia and reperfusion. So it's like HIE. You have hypoxia and then suddenly you have a lot of reperfusion happening and that's why you have a problem. Earlier we said it is hyperosmolality, then reduced osmolality. It affects the cerebral vasculature. It affects the RBCs also. So mannitol is much, it has got a pleiotropic effect. It not only causes reduction in CNS pressure, it also has changes in RBC dynamic, changes in vascular dynamics, which means it is preferable over? Yes, this is a very major point I want to say. Is a lot of people talk about, we can give 3% saline versus mannitol. But if you talk about head-to-head trial, there is one study which shows that 3% saline had a worse outcome and higher mortality compared to mannitol. So if you have to give something, give mannitol. Because whatever reason, it is better in that perspective and over 3% saline in that regard. Second is hypokalemia. We know insulin therapy is major, supplement it, and we'll discuss about that in detail. If you have persistent metabolic acidosis, Naveen, what does it mean?
The persistent, which is not responding to insulin,
so you have got two major things. You've got lactic acidosis versus hyperchloremic. How will you differentiate the two?
Sir, one
by
getting anion gap.
And anion gap, what is the formula for an anion gap?
Basically, it is sodium minus chloride plus bicarbonate.
Yeah. So, how much should it be? What is the usual? 10 to 14. 10, what 10 to 14 is the normal. What happens in DK, usual level?
So, DK is basically a condition where there is high anion gap.
So, it becomes like 20. But if you have very high anion gap with a ketone which is normal, it means it's lactic acidosis. But if your anion gap is low and you have acidosis, it means hyperchloremic. What is the other marker of hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis? An iron gap is there, but it is confusing because it can be high, it can be low, there are other factors. This is more specific marker. So in an iron gap, you said you've got sodium, bicarb and chloride.
Chloride is better.
Yeah, so anything else you can remove, which makes it much easier, clearer out of these three to get that idea that this is hyperchloremic. Can you remove chloride from the equation? You can't, because then it doesn't make sense. Can you remove sodium? So what formula will you get? Sodium minus chloride. Sodium minus chloride minus 32. This is known as, you have mentioned in your slide, chloride load. So normal difference between sodium and chloride is 32. If it is less than 32, it means that the chloride is high. So the best way to look at is either a chloride to sodium ratio of more than 0.79. or a sodium minus chloride minus 32, which is the chloride load. If it is more than 32, if it's positive, it means that there is a hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis. So I would say rather than an iron gap is a good marker at diagnosis of the severity of acidosis. But after that, if you want to do hyperchloremic, go for chloride load. And that's very, very significant from that perspective. So no soda bicarbonate, of course. Now you can also have infections. We already know about that. Thrombosis. This is very, very important. And that's why you have to be cautious. You should not put central lines in this situations and rhabdomyolysis. What is the most important predictor, Dr. Pratik, of rhabdomyolysis? Levels below?
1.7.
Levels below 1. So if we are very low, then rhabdomyolysis will happen. Why does hypophosphatemia cause rhabdomyolysis?
It's to increase muscle contractions.
So basically, you got this twitching sort of a thing, you can say, and that's why you have rhabdomyolysis. Now, thrombosis, rhabdomyolysis, will it be more in DKA or HONK?
Hypophosphatemia more in DKA.
Is more in HONK. Because hypophosphatemia is osmotic diuresis. So that is much more in HONK. So that's why all this is much more common in HONK, but less, it's also there in the setting of DK. What will be the clinical feature of rhabdomyolysis? May or may not, but yes, muscle pain. If you have a pain in the leg or something, they may say, or they may be, patient may be unconscious. That is the most important. So if you have pain or if you have hematuria, you do what? CK level. If CK is high, this is a very, very big risk factor for renal failure. Now, studies have shown that AKI is very, very common in DK. How many children with diabetic ketoacidosis have acute kidney injury? 40 to 60%. So many of them are pre-renal, but a lot of them also have stage 2 and stage 3 AKI as well, which means that they have a tubular dysfunction. They have other problems which are also there. And one of the biggest risk factor is the rhabdomyolysis. So if you have somebody who is developing oliguria, somebody who is developing red colored urine, somebody whose potassium level is rising, do a CK. That would mean that there will be rhabdomyolysis. Do a phosphorus. And then maybe think of doing a phosphorus in that setting will be important from that regards in that perspective. Now, cerebral edema is an important factor, which is a very, very important factor in terms of risk factor, which is there. And we have been always talking about cerebral edema being an osmotic phenomena. So we talked about in hypernatremia, similarly hyperglycemia. So hyperglycemia essentially is a state in which you have got higher osmolality in the plasma. So fluid will come out, cell will become smaller, and you will have the osmoles will be produced inside, maybe butane and other things which will retain fluid in that perspective. And that will cause the normal cell to be maintained. Otherwise, the cell will basically shrink. The problem happens is that if you give insulin and there is a rapid decline in glucose, there would be a sudden shift of fluid inside, and this will cause a sudden burst. And if you give too much fluid, the cell will basically burst and cause cerebral edema induced damage. So most people have always thought that this is the reason. And that's why people were very conservative as far as how much fluid to give. Less fluid will be better. And that's what has been always been taught. But now there are two hypotheses of cerebral edema. One, of course, is this one, which is the osmotic hypothesis. The other hypothesis is that it has nothing to do with fluids. It is an intrinsic problem of the disease. In the disease, what happens is that because of high osmolality, the blood flow is less to the brain. Once you correct it, blood flow becomes more. So this is hypoperfusion, hyperperfusion. So that typical damage which happens in HIE also happens here in that perspective. The proponents of this hypothesis basically means is that you don't bother about fluid. Fluid may not be extremely important, and whatever fluid you give, cerebral edema is going to happen. It's something like people say that whatever happens, CP, some people will become, remain cerebral palsy, whatever good control you will do. I would say the balance is that both of them are important from that perspective. It's not just one, but both hypotheses play an important role. So we don't need to be too restrictive in fluid, but we should not be over aggressive also in that regards. The second hypothesis, so if you give too much bicarbonate, the risk factors were severe disease, insulin bolus, and fluid more than 3 liters per meter squared per day. So if you give too much fluid, too rapid fluctuation, the problems can be happening in that regards. Now, the problem in this is that when people studied, they found that some children will have decay even without any treatment. So even at diagnosis, they will have cerebral edema, which will be there. The other factor was that if you look at studies, in fact, the large studies which are there from the US, 1600 patients, they did not find that it was related to changes in osmolarity. It was related to acidosis. It was related to CO2. It was related to age. So it was related to severity of disease and problems in the child, but not because of osmolality changes. So this questions the whole thing, whether it is all osmolality related or it's so simple in that regards. So this has led to a cytotoxic theory, which basically says there is initial hypoperfusion, then there is reperfusion, something like HIE and inflammation, and that causes damage. But I would say the truth is both are important. So don't give too much fluid, but don't keep them dehydrated also. That is also a big message which comes out of it in that perspective. Now, this is our study which Neha had done, and what we have found that a lot of these patients were actually having cerebral edema diagnosis. But here it is different compared to the Western studies. Now, Western studies, when they say that cerebral edema was there at diagnosis, they had not shown anywhere. The first time they presented there, and then they found. Here, what we are seeing is that these patients had been treated outside. So they received a lot of fluids and other problems, which basically means that fluid therapy also plays an important role in the development of cerebral edema. And what we found was that children who had got new onset diabetes, who had received prior fluid, were at a much higher risk of developing cerebral edema than those who did not. So these are important factors. This was the first big study published around 20 years ago in NEJM of around 1600 DK episodes, and cerebral edema happened in 61. So there the figure is like 1-2% at that time. And what they found was that younger the age group, newly diagnosed, so same thing that we talked about here, somebody who has got a BUN level which is high, which means more dehydration, and partial pressure of oxygen on the lower side. These were the risk factors, which means essentially more severe decay. More severe decay becomes more likely to be cerebral edema. And this is similar to two of these parameters are there as far as our study is also concerned. So a lot of factors are there along with fluid treatment. So if you have somebody whose pH is less than 6.9, whose CO2 is less than 10, who has received fluid outside, is at a very, very high risk of developing cerebral edema, immediately you should start be careful in that setting from preventing this complication from happening. So now, based upon all this, what we can say that there is a tight rope in terms of management of DKA. If you give less fluid, what is going to happen, Sayan?
So the dehydration will persist, the uncontrollability hormones will persist.
So you will have more dehydration. If you give more fluid, what will happen?
So more fluid, increased chances of cerebral edema.
So a risk of cerebral edema will be there. If you give less insulin, Manoj, what will happen?
Diabetic ketoacidosis will not resolve.
So you will take longer time to resolve. If you give too much insulin, what will happen?
There is hypokalemia.
So you will develop hypokalemia. So, Naveen, would you like somebody to have a stay of maybe 14 hours instead of 10 hours, becoming a bit dehydrated, or somebody who dies with hyperedema or hypokalemia? Which one would you prefer?
I prefer a longer stay in hospital.
Yeah, so that's why it's very important that in the current day of age, it is clearly recommended that be less, do less is more. So don't do too much. If you do more, you will do more harm to the patient. And the basic principle of medicine is do no harm. And that's why we talk about lower insulin dose. There are studies of usage of 0.05 as a standard dose, which we'll discuss later on. And fluid correction also on the slower side. So this is what the key message is there in that regards. A word about hyperglycemic, hyperosmolar states. So what are the differences, Dr. Pratik, in this compared to DKA?
First of all, it is more of dehydration, but that is less of dehydration. Biochemically, this has much higher osmolarity from dehydration.
This has no ketoacidosis. Yeah. So as you discussed, it usually happens in the setting of type 2 diabetes. And somebody, as Naveen was talking about, carbonated drinks with type 1, it may have the sugars will go up high. So their hyperglycemia level is very, very high. While in DKA, it is 600, 700 would be unusual or maybe less likely. Here it will start from 600 and above. And if there, you'll be usually very obese individuals. So now what will happen is that you will have a basal glucose more than 600, which will cause a lot of loss of osmotic substances. So osmotic diuresis will be much more. So you will have more hypokalemia, you will have more hypophosphatemia, you will have more hyponatremia here as well. There will be severe dehydration. Now this will increase osmolality. Increase in osmolality will cyan cause what? So that will cause more hyponatremia. This is there. Anything else this high osmolality does?
It will cause increased dehydration, increased hypoperfusion to the brain.
And it also, so osmolality goes above 320, 325. It causes effect on the brain to, brain will become confused. And because of that, the thirst center will become less. And that's why drinking of water becomes less. So again, it's a continuation problem. If your sodium becomes very high, the thirst center becomes obtunded. You won't drink more water and this whole process keeps on going. So this is why you can have very severe hypernatremia, which may happen. Very importantly, it will also have an impact on insulin overall. And these two components also have less chances of ketogenesis. So as I said, high osmolality will have an impact on ketogenesis. What will happen there? If osmolality is high, what happens to ketogenesis? Will be suppressed. So high osmolality itself causes suppression of ketogenesis. That's why you do not develop that much ketosis. So it's a vicious cycle. It is not only causing the brain to say, don't drink more, become worse. It is also not allowing other signals to be there. So if you have ketosis, you will be saved. People will say, okay, he's breathing very fast. He's looking sick. So what will happen? This will be an obese child who has been drinking a lot of water and all, and he's sleepy. And most people will be happy he doesn't have a problem. So that's why this will become very serious when the child presents to you in that perspective. So ketosis becomes less likely. So ketone is less than 1.5. pH is more than 7.3 in that setting. Now, HHS, what happens to hydration? How much are they dehydrated? It's double. So typically when you say 7 to 10, you're talking about at least 10 to 15%. So double dehydration as compared to what? How do you assess dehydration? Do you assess it rightly or wrongly here? Under or over?
So in this case, we assess normally because...
Because again?
Because there's no ketoacidosis to pass out of this thing.
And the turgor will be more because their osmolality is very high. So whatever fluid is there... Fluid is in the cellular compartment. It's in the blood compartment. But outside, everything else has been drained out. So they are at a very, very high risk. Once they develop diuresis, they will develop into shock. What about sodium? More or less? You are losing a lot of sodium, and because of the hyperosmolality, AVP comes into the picture, and this AVP will also cause hyponatremia. So you will have huge hyponatremia also in that setting, and that's why sodium, you need to be very, very cautious in that regards. Now, again, you have to correct from that. What about potassium deficit? Less or more? More potassium deficit again, and you have to be careful in that perspective, in that situation. So this is relevant from that regards to understand. Now, phosphorus will be lower compared to DK. And what does it mean? That they are at a higher risk of? So you have to be very cautious. Here, prophylactic potassium may play a role. How do you monitor for rhabdomyolysis to happen? Is happening or not?
So one with the patient's consciousness will be pretty low. So the pain and all, it won't complain. So clinically,
much. That is too late. So you can measure creatinine kinase every 2 to 4 hours. So these are, this is how it's subtle differences. So if you have hyperosmolar, you actually monitor CK levels. You monitor urine output very carefully. You monitor potassium much more carefully, because if you have that problem, that can be a huge confusion and problem which may happen. So